I used to introduce this song as if this song is about a 47-year-old housewife from Montgomery, Alabama. And she's been married a long time, but her husband doesn't ever talk to her, and he just kind of gets up in the morning, eats breakfast, and takes off to work, and comes home at the end of the day, and eats dinner, and watches a little TV, and goes to bed. And one morning, she got to thinking about this after he'd left for work. So she was sitting there in the living room sofa, watching the dust particles come through the picture window and land on the coffee table like little airplanes on an aircraft carrier. And she was kind of beside herself. So she reached behind the sofa and pulled out her Martin guitar and sang this song. I am an old woman, named after my mother. My old man is another. Child has grown old. If dreams were lightning and thunder were desire, this old house would have burnt down a long time ago. Make me an angel that flies from Montgomery. Make me a poster of an old rodeo. Just give me one thing that I can hold on to be leaving this living is just a hard way to go.
That's John Prine, one of 80,000 people that we've lost to COVID-19 in the first 2 months here in 2020. Amazing songwriter and singer. And I think the way he would prefer to be remembered instead of a casualty of this awful time is as a singer-songwriter, which is a segue into our third and final project, your singer-songwriter album cover, coming up right after this incredibly engaging 70s cartoon music introductory segment.
You sure got it. Oh, honey, honey. You are my candy girl, and you got me wanting you. Sugar, sugar, you are my candy girl, and you got me wanting you. I just can't believe the loveliness of loving you. I just can't believe it's true. I just can't believe the wonder of this feeling too. I just can't believe it's true.
So, third and final assignment here in Alan's art class in the spring of 2020. You're going to be making an album cover, a singer-songwriter album cover. If we were in the classroom, I have actual 12 by 12 inch cardboard white album cover blanks, and they're nice and stiff and feel like and look like real album covers. But since we're not, you'll just have to do the best you can with a piece of blank paper. It doesn't have to be 12 by 12. A little bit larger might be easier. Now, to clarify, before I start telling you what the singer-songwriter album cover looks like, I want to make sure you understand, work with what you have. You can do this in any style. Pen and ink, pencil, collage, digital art, if you know how to do that. Whatever works for you. And I'm looking for three things in your singer-songwriter album cover. I want your name on it, your actual name. Don't make up a band name. Number two, I want an album title. And I want three song titles. You don't have to write the lyrics. You don't have to sing the songs. Just put them on the album cover. And the whole thing should feel like a singer-songwriter album from any time from the 1970s today. And what a singer-songwriter album cover is a very personal style of music. People didn't always sing personally. The Beatles were a revelation. They wrote and sang their own music. Before that, you had Frank Sinatra singing other people's music. You had Elvis Presley singing other people's music. To this day, you still have lots of bands, Backstreet Boys and Justin Timberlake, and people who sing mostly other people's music. But when the Beatles came along, they did something extraordinary. They wrote and recorded their own music. And one of the Beatles' names was John Lennon. And John was a really interesting character. And he, at the time, at the height of the Beatles' popularity, was arguably the most famous person in the world, possibly one of the most popular and famous people of all time. He could go anywhere in the world and people would know him and they would know the Beatles. And at the height of this fame, he bumps into a woman in an art gallery in London named Yoko Ono, and she knows his name, and she goes, "Oh, you're the guy who makes those silly pop songs. Why don't you sing about something important?" And this was a radical idea, a big shakeup in John Lennon's world, that suddenly somebody wasn't so impressed with his songs, which were terrific songs, but still pop songs. Well, shake it up, baby, now. Shake it up, baby. You think you've lost your love? Well, I saw her yesterday, yeah. I wanna hold your hand. What it don't get, I can use. Now give me money. What I want. I got no kick against modern jazz. Unless I try to play it too darn fast. From then on, he starts recording songs like this. Don't let me down. Saving up your money for a rainy day. Giving all your clothes to charity. All we are saying is give Jesus a chance. Okay, beautiful, yeah. Imagine all the people living. These are like really intense personal songs. And in particular, I want you to take a look. Here's some of John's albums. So here's John's Imagine album, which was huge. That was his biggest seller. Here's John's album Mind Games. John Lennon, around this time, he wrote a song called Instant Karma. And his dream was, wouldn't it be great to just think of a song, record the song, and get it out in real time, like within a week. It was unimaginable back then. Today, everyone can do it, right? Here's an album, one of his last albums, his posthumous last album, called Milk and Honey, with his wife Yoko. And here's the last album he did, right? He was killed right the day this hit number one, I think, is when he was killed. And this album's called Double Fantasy. So you'll notice the similarity between these two albums. So he ended up marrying Yoko Ono. It was very controversial. She suffered a lot as an artist, as a woman, as an Asian. She suffered racism, she suffered misogyny, and she also suffered because her art was just really far out and a lot of people couldn't handle it. They made this album. It's kind of hard to find. It's called Heart Play. They had someone follow them around the summer right before John was killed and just record them talking about life and relationships and what it means to be a man. And he was one of the first house husbands in the world, certainly the first famous celebrity households. Here's the album I want to talk about. This is John's earliest album. And in this album, I want you to take a look at the Beatles right here at the start of their career. Okay, there you go. Yeah, 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 love me do, want to hold your hand. Good music, catchy music. We still listen to it today. Now I want you to listen to a little snippet from this album. In this album, John gets as real as you can get. This is so personal, and he finally addresses the fact that his mother had abandoned him when he was a young kid, took him to her sister's house, brought him to the house, and then snuck out the back door, and he didn't see her again for years. Left him there. His father had already abandoned him. When he found out that that John's mother was pregnant with John, the father disappeared as well. Father only reappeared once at the height of John's fame to ask for money. John's mother, however, appeared a couple years after abandoning him, showed up again. She and John were able to reconnect. John described it as one of the happiest few months of his life, and then his mother ended up getting killed by a drunk driver. So, John then goes on, forms the Beatles with Paul McCartney and George Harrison and Ringo Starr, and they become huge, huge, huge. They change the world with their music and their look and their politics and everything else. And then John, all of this time, is angry. If you look at interviews from that time, people that knew John say he was a very unpleasant human being. In this album, he explores that anger finally. He goes to a psychotherapist who encourages him to scream out his pain, and he records this song, Mother. And listen to the lyrics. Mother, you had me, but I never had you. Father, you left me, but I never left you. And he spends the last 2 minutes of the song screaming, Mama, don't go. Daddy, come home.
Mama, don't go. Daddy, come home. Mama, don't go. Daddy, come home.
So, let's talk very briefly about the history of the singer-songwriter movement. Here's a famous Alan PowerPoint narrated by me. So for our third and final assignment of this quarter, you're going to be making a singer-songwriter album cover. And you're not going to be recording any songs, but what I'm hoping you'll come up with is some artwork that matches the title of your album, that matches three song titles and thematically. And what I want you to do is think about, in this time, don't try to summarize your whole life. If you were a singer-songwriter, what would you be singing about right here, right now? In this time, what would your album look like if you were putting one out right now? So, to start with, singer-songwriters, really, when we talk about singer-songwriters, we're talking about the 1970s, and I'll tell you some of the famous people. But singer-songwriters really go back to the days of the ancient bards, singing their songs, strolling from town to town, recording the history of the time, and singing about kings and battles and things that were going on. Moving ahead a few centuries, we start to get to the early 1920s and 30s, and artists like Leadbelly, who are singing personal songs in a style called the blues, personal songs about things that happened to them, things that they saw around them, really tales of hardship, which is why to this day we use the term the blues. I'm feeling the blues, right? Because of this music, singing songs of real trials and tribulations. And you get Woody Guthrie comes along in the 1930s, early 1940s, also singing topical songs, starts to get a little more political. You all know the song, This Land Is Your Land, This Land Is My Land, from California to the New York Islands, right? He starts singing songs about the American working class and the struggles that they're undergoing, and he sings a whole bunch of songs about the Dust Bowl that was going on in Oklahoma. Fast forward ahead another 15 to 20 years, and somebody who grew up absolutely idolizing Woody Guthrie to the point where, as a young, unknown singer-songwriter, he journeys to Woody Guthrie's deathbed and hangs out with him for his last few weeks of his life, swapping stories and songs and talking with him. And I'm talking about here Bob Dylan. So young Bob Dylan, often compared to Woody Guthrie on his first album or two, before he finds his own voice and goes into his own style. So Bob Dylan really pushes the idea of the singer-songwriter, but again, we're still talking fairly topical for a while. It takes Bob Dylan a few years to start to make a few personal songs. He's still really singing these terrific songs that he's written about other people's problems. But when we're talking singer-songwriter, we're talking about our own problems. The singer-songwriter movement comes in the wake of this, and at the same time, right around the landing on the moon, right, 69, 70, we start to get confessional poetry. Anne Sexton and Sylvia Plath get discovered, and their poetry becomes, and then suddenly it seems like out of nowhere, everybody is making personal songs about their feelings. And we've got Melanie and Laura Nero and Lottie Golden and Joni Mitchell
who also made her own artwork on many of her album covers. So these album covers right here by Joni are her own artwork. Here she is, look at Dissolving. Who am I? Who am I? Ladies of the Canyon. I'm living here. I'm not sure who I am. Joni Mitchell writes some extraordinary songs. I hope you'll listen to some of her albums while you're doing your artwork. Certainly you'll know the song Clouds or maybe The Circle Game. And here's another one. So look at the different styles. These are styles you can use on your album cover. Joni doing a pencil, pen and ink, colored pencil kind of thing. Here she's doing collage art. The first one, let me go back real quick. This one here, right, she's painted herself as a self-portrait. And this one, she's got the pencil, colored pencil. Here she's doing collage. Here's Carly Simon, just a picture against the background. No Secrets. Notice the title, right? No Secrets. I'm going to tell my whole life in this album. Here's James Taylor, who's come here to Ashland several times, played at the Brit Festival. Here's him looking sensitive. Here's Marvin Gaye. What's going on, right? It's tough to be a black man in the 1960s. Malcolm X has been killed. Martin Luther King's been killed. Society's in a state of upheaval. And Marvin Gaye puts out this album against his record label's wishes, right? They told him not to do it. And he said, I don't care. And you want an album, here it is. So he put this album out. It's fantastic. I hope you listen to it. And here's Cat Stevens, who did lots and lots of songs, personal songs about his relationship with his father and trying to find his own voice and his search for spiritual truths. Here's Van Morrison, another extraordinary singer-songwriter who's still out there, been performing for 60 years now. Look at the album covers. Here's all ideas for how to approach it. Here's Jim Croce. There's John Prine on the left, who we started off with, Harry Chapin. Here's Carole King, one of my absolute favorites, right? She wrote some of the most famous songs of the 1960s. Not Hanky Panky, that was her friend. She wrote just tons and tons of songs that were recorded by bands like the Monkees and the Crystals and the Shirelles. And she kept trying to put the songs out herself, and she kept getting shut down by the system, by the male patriarchy. Finally, she gets this album out, Carole King's Tapestry, and it becomes the soundtrack for the women's movement of the early 1970s. If you're watching the show on Hulu, Mrs. America, this would be one of the songs that should be in there somewhere. Take a listen. Here's Neil Diamond. You all know this song, Sweet Caroline. And singer-songwriters still going on today, right? Jack Johnson, Adele, Taylor Swift, Kanye, people are still doing it. Just sounds a little different than it did back in the 1970s. You don't have to be stuck in the 70s. It's your album.
That's your assignment. It's your last assignment. Get me something in the next 3 weeks. And don't look at it as an assignment. Look at it as an opportunity, which is what singer-songwriters do. It's an opportunity to explore yourself and your feelings. Don't try to capture your whole self. Capture yourself right now in the spring of 2020 in distance learning in the time of coronavirus and COVID-19. What are you going through? What are you feeling? What's your life got going on in it? What would you be singing about if you were a singer-songwriter?
Love me do. Oh, love me do. Think you've lost your love? Well, I saw her yesterday. Oh, and this boy would be happy just to love you. I do all the pleasing with you. It's so hard to reason with you. Oh, yeah. Why do you make me blue? If there's anything that you want, if there's anything I can do, that yes, I will. I'll get you in the end.
I've been told when a boy kisses a girl, take a trip around the world. Hey, hey.
I wanna hold your hand. Here am I, sitting all on my own. All my loving
that you would love me more than her.
And I love her.
Before this dance is through, I think I'll love you too. I'm so happy when you dance with me. And I'll be satisfied. Tell me that you want the kind of things the money just can't buy.
Because I told you before, oh, you can't do that.
She's in love with me and I feel fine.
My love don't give me presents. I know that she's no peasant.
No kick against modern jazz, unless they try to play it too darn fast and lose the beauty of the melody. Oh dear, what can I do? Baby's in black and I'm feeling blue. Tell me, oh, what can I do? She's got a ticket to ride. Help me if you can, I'm feeling down. And another girl. I need you. But when you told me you would change your mind, treat me like you did the night before, you're gonna lose that,
yes,
girl.
Yes, you're gonna lose that girl.
You're gonna lose,
yes, yes, you're
that,
gonna girl.
Lose that girl. Hey, you've got to hide your love away.
Run the risk of knowing
sunshine.
Don't